Check, check, 1, 2.
You have
These two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. The Lord mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Set us free, loving Father, from the bondage of our sins. And in your goodness and mercy, give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the reading and hearing of God's word.
A reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter 45, beginning with the first verse. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped, to subdue nations before him and to loose the belts of kings, to open doors before him that gates may not be closed. I will go before you and level the exalted places. I will break in pieces the doors of bronze and cut through the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and the hoards in secret places, that you may know that it is I, the Lord, the God of Israel, who call you by your name. For the sake of my servant Jacob and Israel my chosen, I call you by your name. I name you, though you do not know me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I equip you, though you do not know me, that people may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is none besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form light and create darkness. I make well-being and create calamity. I am the Lord who does all these things. The word of the Lord. A reading from the book of 1 Thessalonians, chapter 1, beginning with the first verse. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians, in God the Father and in the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace. We give thanks to God always for all of you, constantly mentioning you in our prayers, remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love, and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers loved by God, that he has chosen you, because our gospel came to you not only in word, but also in power, and in the Holy Spirit, and with full conviction. And you know what kind of men we proved to be among you for your sake. And you became imitators of us and of the Lord, for you received the word in much affliction with the joy of the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and in Achaia. For not only has the word of God sounded forth from you in Macedonia and Achaia, but your faith in God has gone forth everywhere, so that we need not say anything. For they themselves report concerning us the kind of reception we had among you, and how you turn to God from idols to serve the living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Would you please stand now and join together in our prayer for children this morning, praying for all children, our own and children of our community and of the world. O gracious God, our Heavenly Father, keep watch over our children in this unsteady and confusing world. Mercifully care for them and teach them that your 22, beginning at the 15th verse. Then the Pharisees went and plotted how to entangle Jesus in his words. And they sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are true and teach the way of God truthfully, and you do not care about anyone's opinion, for you are not swayed by appearances. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why put me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. And Jesus said to them, "Whose likeness and inscription is this?" They said, "Caesar's." And he said to them, "Therefore render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard it, they marveled, and they left him and went away. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
And now, Father, thank you, Lord, for your presence with us this morning. Thank you for the power of your Spirit in our midst. By your Spirit, Lord, let your word be spoken and your word alone received. We ask in Christ's name. Mistaken identity can get us in trouble.
It can be a problem.
You may have heard about the fellow that was driving in heavy, heavy traffic, and the light went yellow in front of him, and so dutifully he stopped at the light. But the woman behind him was in a real rush, and she couldn't believe he stopped at the yellow light. She honked, and she screamed, and she pounded on the steering wheel, and she was cursing him at the top of her voice. And in mid-ramp, she noticed there was a tap on her window, and she looked there, and there was a policeman. Well, he had to get out of the car. He handcuffed her, arrested her, and took her to the police station, where she was fingerprinted, put in a cell, and left. A couple of hours later, she was brought out to the main desk there in the police station, and the arresting officer was there, and he saw her, and he apologized to her. He said, "Ma'am," he said, "I'm so sorry. But, you know, I was right behind you there at the intersection, and I saw your behavior, and I saw the Christian fish in your car, and the What Would Jesus Do bumper sticker, and the Follow Me to Sunday School bumper sticker, and I just assumed you'd stolen the car." Mistaken ID, right? That can be a minor issue. It could be more important, let's say, if you're mistaken about God's identity. Do we have his correct ID? We come to church, hopefully we've come to church to worship God, to declare his praise, as the psalmist says, to sing to him and bless his name and proclaim his salvation and declare his glory and his wonders, as we just did in that great song, "Behold Our God." But how do we picture him? What's our conception of God? How do we think of God? J.B. Phillips, in his classic book, Your God is Too Small, outlined some of the common modern misconceptions about God. Some folks today see him as a cosmic policeman, whose main concern is to punish sinners. Some see God as a mean and demanding parent, perhaps like one of their parents. Some see him as a grand old man, you know, once powerful, but not really up to the challenges of the modern world. Some see him as meek and mild, gentle Jesus, always affirming and never disapproving. Some see him as the opposite, a tyrant who demands 100% perfection that's never satisfied with us. Many today see him as defined by their particular belief system, and you hear the phrase, "That's not the God I worship." And finally, and sadly, some, maybe perhaps many, see God as kind of the CEO, kind of got the big picture, got it all started, but is not really into the details of my life. Well, the Lord's revelation of himself in the scripture paints a very different picture from all of that. David W. Harper wrote a book a few years back, I guess 2013, called The Experience of God, and in that book, he gives a great summary of the scriptural revelation of God. And I'm going to quote here from David Bentley Hart, The Experience of God. "God is the one infinite source of all that is, eternal, omniscient, omnipotent,
omnipresent, uncreated, uncaused, perfectly transcendent of all things, and for that reason, absolutely immanent to all things. He is not one more object in an inventory of things that are, or any sort of discrete object at all. Rather, all things that exist receive their being continuously from him, who is the infinite wellspring of all that is, in whom all things live and move and have their being, the inexhaustible source of all reality, infinite being, infinite consciousness, infinite bliss, from whom we are, by whom we know and are known, and in whom we find our only true consummation. Hart contends that that sort of big picture, the existential nature of God, if you will, is not just for the Christians. It's common to all the great theistic religions of the earth: Judaism, Christianity, Islam, Sikhism, Hinduism, Baha'i, and much of ancient paganism as well. He's not saying that all those religions worship the same God, but he's saying in God's existential nature, that picture is common across all the theistic religions. There is a supreme being like that. Of course, our God, the Christian God, has some attributes that the other religions wouldn't sign up for, like loving us, that kind of thing. But with that picture, my question is, with J.B. Phillips, is your God too small? We get a little picture of this, our God, in our reading from Isaiah this morning. Here, God is calling Cyrus, the great Persian king, to be God's servant, to do God's bidding. God is going to, he says, to hold Cyrus by the right hand, and he's going to lead him in power to subdue kings and nations, to break down cities and walls, to plunder great treasures. And God is going to do all of this through Cyrus. And he calls Cyrus by name. In fact, God names Cyrus, though Cyrus doesn't know God, and God's telling him all of this before it happens, so that Cyrus will know and people will know that it is all God's doing through Cyrus. That God alone, as he said in our reading, is God, and that there are none besides me. God says, I am the Lord, there's no other. I form the light and the darkness. I create well-being and calamity. I am the Lord. And all that happened just as God said it would through Isaiah. But here's the thing, God said all of that through Isaiah 150 years before Cyrus came into existence, 150 years before he came to power, 150 years before anybody knew of Cyrus. So, do you get the picture? God is omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent. Past, present, and future, it's all present to him. He calls Cyrus by name. He names Cyrus 150 years before Cyrus comes onto the scene. Historically, he names him to conquer nations and to set the Jews free from slavery in Babylon and return them to the promised land, which is exactly what Cyrus did, and God spoke it 150 years ahead, so we can know that God did it and we can understand his nature. That all history, he's the author of history, that it all holds together in him, that he started history and he controls its flow and its outcome. Is your God too small? The scripture says that he knows each of us, he knows each of us before we were even conceived. He knows the events of our lives, the number of our years, the number of hairs on our heads. Oh, that's becoming increasingly easy to do for some of us. He's continually speaking. He's always speaking to us. He's always calling to us and wooing us. And everything about our lives, every event, every beat of our heart, every breath that we take is by his permission and his supervision. And he gives us this amazing freedom. We talked about it last week. He gives us amazing freedom to say no, to make choices, to say no to him, even to say no to his plan for us. Even to ignore him, we have the freedom to do that. And all of that, for every human being on the planet, he works into the overall sweep of history, and it works all together in the end toward the eventual return of Jesus Christ. With God sorting it all out, setting the world straight, a new heaven and a new earth, justice and peace prevailing, and a white robe of righteousness for any who will take it. Is that your God? It's the God of our faith, revealed in Scripture, of Jew and of Christian, Old Testament and New. And I tell you all of that because it's some interesting, more than interesting, it's some important background on Jesus' answer today to the Pharisees and the Herodians. Now, the Pharisees and the Herodians hated each other. The Pharisees hated the Herodians. The Herodians, you may remember, were compromisers with the Roman oppressors. They were go-along, get-along people. And so the Pharisees thought they were traitors. The Herodians hated the Pharisees because the Pharisees were religious zealots, and their zealotry was going to get Rome to tighten up even more on the Jews, and so the Herodians hated that. And their fear together was of Jesus and his huge popularity. So they're both, they team up together because they've got to stop Jesus before he stirs up the crowds too much and brings Roman authority down, crashing on all of them. And so they work together here to trap Jesus. So they tried to soften him up with flattery, which doesn't work with Jesus. I don't know if you ever tried that. He's not impressed. Then they ask the question that they think he can't answer this without cutting his own throat. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? It's a trap, they think. If he says yes, it's lawful to pay tax to Caesar, then he's a traitor to Judaism. He's advocating support of the Roman oppressor. But if he says no, don't pay your taxes, then he's guilty of insurrection against Rome. Either way, it's a capital offense. They think, we've got him, you know, checkmate. And then Jesus stuns them. He silences them with this profound answer. Bring me a coin, he says. What's on it? Well, the likeness and inscription of Caesar as a god. Jesus says, give to Caesar what is Caesar's. Give to God what is his, what is God's. So it's a brilliant answer. He can't be charged with either offense. He's not disloyal to the Jews. Doesn't seem to be disloyal to Rome. It's a brilliant answer. But don't miss the subtlety here, the beauty, the judgment in this answer. Give to Caesar what is Caesar's. Give to God, in other words, that's not God over there. His inscription's on the coin. Might say he's God, but he's not. Give to Caesar what is Caesar's. Give to the Lord what is his. Now, what would a good Jew think belongs to God? What does Scripture say belongs to God? Just been talking about it this morning. Absolutely everything. God is over all, in all, the source of all power and authority, ruler over all rulers. God is, to him is owed all loyalty and allegiance and worship and honor and praise and glory. All of that is his due. He's the creator and sustainer of life, of all things. He owns the earth and all that dwell therein. He's the source of all life. Everything we have is from his hand. Every breath that we take, we owe him everything. So Jesus is saying, yes, sure, pay your taxes. That's not God, but, you know, pay your taxes, civil law, do your civic duty. But in terms of surrender, submission, devotion, love of your heart, the honor that you would give, worship, loyalty, control, seeking direction, every decision you're thinking about, all that belongs to God. Give to God what belongs to God. Give God the things that are his means. Give him everything. I think Rome's in charge. I think Caesar's in charge. The federal government. The government only has the power that God gave it, and to give the government its due, well, that's the easy part, isn't it? You don't like paying taxes? Do it, pretty much. Give God the things that are his means. Give him everything. Absolutely, all that we are and all that we have is his. And yes, he does let us say no. He lets us hold back, to turn away, to refuse. But if you understand what we're saying, if you understand what the scripture, the author of life, the sustainer of life, we say no to him, and what is another word for that? Death. So my question this morning is, how are we doing? I don't know about you, but most of us are disheartened, I guess I would say, by the situation in the government these days. We're maybe less likely to, or less inclined to give to Caesar what is Caesar's, but nevertheless, we're probably still paying our taxes. We're trying to stay informed. We're going to vote. We pretty much obey the laws of our country, leaving aside the speed limit and some things like that, but you know what I'm saying. We do this. That's the easy part. Rendering unto God what is his. That's another matter. That's a lifelong seeking, a lifelong, hopefully, habit of submission, of surrender, of service, of giving, of worship. Not done out of a should or an ought or a have to or grudgingly, but done from a heart which is overflowing with love for him, joy, appreciation for what he has done out of love for us. Give to God what is God's. It's simple, simple phrase. Let it be burned in our hearts. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for your love for us and for your amazing provision for us, even down to the provision of giving us choices. Help us to be those who give you all. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Will you stand now? We are going to sing our creed. Thank you. Please stand.
For the peace of the whole world and for the well-being and unity of the people of God, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For Foley, our Archbishop, and Mark, our Bishop, and for all the clergy and people of our diocese and congregation, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
for all who proclaim the gospel at home and abroad, and for all who teach and disciple others. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For our brothers and sisters in Christ who are persecuted for their faith, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For our president, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all those who are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or other adversity, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all those who departed this life in the certain hope of the resurrection, in thanksgiving, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. You are invited to add your prayers either silently or aloud.
Mackie and Joyce. Julia. Johnny Mack. Heavenly Father, grant these our prayers for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. This saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Please greet one another safely, sharing God's peace. Peace, Danny. Please be seated. Warm welcome to you. Love to have you register with us, if you would, this morning, your attendance on your bulletin. There's a tear-off side, the Connect card, and we'd love to hear from you if you wouldn't mind filling that out. We're glad you joined us today. We're still live streaming this service and the 11 o'clock. We pray that you'll continue to come to church. We've been safe here. No contagion passed in the services that we're aware of, and we're staying safe with our masks, and I appreciate that. I see everybody's masked up this morning, except me and Carrie, because we're going to be speaking or singing shortly. Everybody else is to keep their masks on, and we do appreciate that. This is our collection month, again, October for Helping Hand. The basket's out there. It's pretty full, but they'll empty it shortly, and we can fill it up again. They've got room to take everything that we can possibly bring, so I encourage you to do that and to send us a picture. We are collecting photos still for our Breeze database, online photo directory. We're close to having a new rector. And he and his family will need photos so that they can quickly learn names and faces. I mean, some of you they'll learn instantly because you're so distinctive. Others, I'll let you figure that out. Seriously, some are easier than others, but just they'll need the directory. And we all need it, frankly. It helps bind us together, so we need your picture. The new audiovisual system is here. Ashley, do you want to talk about its status? We owe a great thanks to Ashley for all her efforts on this and making it work, and going to be training other people on it, which, by the way, we need more people. If you're willing to help, we could still use some volunteers to help. My iPhone, yes, on a tripod, yes. Thank you. Thanks, Ashley. And last but not least, I ask your continued prayers. I'm gonna switch from calling it the rector search process to the rector calling process. We are down to a call, and so we're very near completion. And I just ask your prayers for those final details to fall into place, hopefully this week, and that you would have a new rector on board for one Advent, which the first Sunday of the church year, which would be November 29th. God willing, we will be there then. And you'll fall in love with the new rector and his family, I guarantee it. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice to God.
Now the darkness fades.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, our duty and our joy always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Love you made us for yourself, and when we had sinned against you and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent your only Son into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us. In obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death we might be saved. By his resurrection, he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. As our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory, that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. And we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit and word to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Sanctify us also that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him so that he may dwell in us and we in him. And bring us with all your saints into the fullness of your heavenly kingdom where we shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed once for all upon the cross. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. We do not presume to come to this, your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. Apart from your grace, we are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table. But you are the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb.
Thank you.
pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. And now may the Holy Trinity make you strong in faith and love, defend you on every side, and guide you in truth and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Didn't see a lot of dancing in that last song, so maybe next time, folks. Hallelujah. Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.